All right, everybody, be forewarned, this is kind of a dark one. If you're not familiar, Arthur Rimbaud was a 19th century French poet, considered something of a wild child and a rebel. A lot of his poetry has kind of a dark, defiant tone that really resonated with me when I was a young, tortured artist type. I like to think I've lightened up a lot, but his work still resonates with me. I first learned about Rimbaud through reading a biography about Jim Morrison. And back in my early 20s, I actually corresponded back and forth for a while with a college professor who wrote a book entitled Rimbaud and Jim Morrison, The Rebel as Poet. But anyway, let's get this show on the road. Here we go. Arthur Rimbaud's A Season in Hell. A Season in Hell. Once, if I remember well, my life was a feast where all hearts opened and all wines flowed. One evening I seated beauty on my knees, and I found her bitter, and I cursed her. I armed myself against justice. I fled, O witches, O misery, O hate. To you my treasure has been entrusted. I contrived to purge my mind of all human hope, on all joy to strangle it. I pounced with the stealth of a wild beast. I called to the executioners that I might gnaw their rifle butts while dying. I called to the plagues to smother me in blood, in sand. Misfortune was my god. I laid myself down in the mud. I dried myself in the air of crime. I played sly tricks on madness. And spring brought me the idiot's frightful laughter. Now only recently, being on the point of giving my last squawk, I thought of looking for the key to the ancient feast, where I might find my appetite again. Charity is that key. This inspiration proves that I have dreamed. You will always be a hyena, etc., protest the devil, who crowned me with such pleasant poppies. Attain death with all your appetites, your selfishness, and all the capital sins. Ah, I'm fed up, but dear Satan, a less fiery eye I beg you. And while waiting a few small infamies and arrears, you who love the absence of the instructive or descriptive faculty in a writer, for you let me tear out these few hideous pages from my notebook of one of the damned. Bad blood. I have the white-blue eye of my Gallic ancestors, their narrow skull and their clumsiness in fighting. I find my clothes as barbarous as theirs, only I don't butter my hair. The Gauls were the most inept flayers of beast and scorchers of grass of their time. From them, too, idolatry and love of sacrilege. Oh, all the vices, anger, lust magnificent above all, lying and sloth. I have a horror of all trades, masters and workers, base peasants all. The hand that guides the pen is worth the hand that guides the plow. What an age of hands! I shall never have my hand. Afterward, domesticity leads too far. The honesty of beggars sickens me. Criminals disgust like castrates. As for me, I am intact, and I don't care. But who gave me so perfidious a tongue that it has guided and guarded my indolence till now? Without even using my body for a living and lazier than the toad, I have lived everywhere, not a family of Europe that I do not know. I mean families like my own that owe everything to the Declaration of the Rights of Man. I have known all the sons of good families. Had I but antecedents at some point in the history of France, but no, nothing. It is quite clear to me that I have always been of an inferior race. I cannot understand revolt. My race never rose except to pillage, like wolves that worry the beasts they have not killed. I recall the history of France, eldest daughter of the church. A villain I must have made the journey to the Holy Land. My head is full of the roads through the Swabian plains, views of Byzantium, ramparts of Jerusalem, the cult of Mary. Compassion for the crucified Christ awaken me among a thousand profane phantasmagoria. A leper, I am seated among potsherds and nettles at the foot of a sun-eaten wall. Later a writer, I must have bivouacked under German stars. Ah, what's more, I dance the witch's Sabbath in a red clearing with old women and children. I can remember no farther back than this very land and Christianity. I shall never have done seeing myself in that past, but always alone, without family, and even the language that I spoke. What was it? I cannot see myself at the councils of Christ, nor at the councils of nobles, representatives of Christ. What was I in the last century? I find no trace again until today. No more vagabonds, no more vague wars. The inferior race has overrun everything. The people, as we say, the nation, reason, science. Oh, science, everything has been revised. For the body and for the soul, the viaticum, there are medicine and philosophy, old wives, remedies and popular songs rearranged, and the pastimes of princes and games they prescribed, geography, cosmography, mechanics, chemistry, science, the new nobility, progress, the world marches on. Why shouldn't it turn? It is the vision of numbers. We are going toward the spirit. There's no doubt about it. An oracle. I tell you, I understand. And not knowing how to express myself without pagan words, I'd rather remain silent. Pagan blood returns. The spirit is near. Why doesn't Christ help me by granting my soul nobility and liberty? Alas, the gospel has gone by. The gospel, greedily I await God. I am of an inferior race for all eternity. Here I am on the Breton shore. Let the towns light up in the evening. My day is done. I'm quitting Europe. Sea air will burn my lungs. Strange climates will tan my skin. To swim, to trample the grass, to hunt, and above all, to smoke, to drink liquors, strong as boiling metal. Like my dear ancestors around their fires. I'll return with limbs of iron, dark skin and furious eye. People will think to look at me that I am of a strong race. I will have gold. I will be idle and brutal. Women nurse those fierce invalids home from hot countries. I'll be mixed up in politics, saved. Now I am an outcast. I loathe the fatherland. The thing for me is a very drunken sleep on the beach. We're not going back over the old roads again, laden with my vice, the vice whose roots of suffering have flourished at my side since reason dawned. That rises to the skies, belabors me, knocks me down, drags me along. The last innocence and that last timidity. It's settled not to display my betrayals and disgust to the world. Forward, the march, the burden, and the desert, weariness and anger. To whom shall I hire myself out? What beast should I adore? What holy image is attacked? What heart shall I break? What lies should I uphold? In what blood tread? Rather steer clear of the law, the hard life, simple brutishness, to lift with withered fist the coffin's lid, to sit, to suffocate, and thus no old age, no dangers. Terror is not French. Ah, I am utterly forsaken that to any divine image whatsoever I offer my impulses toward perfection. O my abnegation, O my marvelous charity. Here below, however, de profundis domine, what a fool I am. Still but a child, I admired the intractable convict, on whom the prison doors are always closing. I sought out the inns and rooming houses he would have consecrated by his passing. With his idea, I saw the blue sky and the flowery labor of the country. In cities, I sensed his fatality. He had more strength than a saint, more common sense than a traveler, and he alone, the witness of his glory and his reason. On high roads on winter nights, without roof, without clothes, without bread, a voice gripped my frozen heart. Weakness or strength, there you are. It's strength. You do not know where you are going, nor why you are going. Enter anywhere. Reply to anything. They will no more kill you than if you were a corpse. In the morning I had a look so lost, a face so dead, that perhaps those whom I met did not see me. In cities, suddenly the mud seemed red and black like a mirror, when the lamp moves about in the adjoining room, like a treasure in the forest. Good luck, I cried, and I saw a sea of flames and smoke in the sky. To the right, to the left, all the riches of the world, flaming like a billion thunderbolts. But to me, debauch and the comradeship of women were denied. Not even a companion. I saw myself before an infuriated mob, facing the firing squad, weeping out of pity for the evil they could not understand, and forgiving, like Jeanne d'Arc, Priests, professors, masters, you are making a mistake in turning me over to the law. I have never belonged to this people. I have never been a Christian. I am the race who sang under torture, laws I have never understood. I have no moral sense. I am a brute. You are making a mistake. I just want to give a brief warning before we continue. The next passage or section is peppered liberally with the N-word. It's not my intention to try to offend anyone. I'm just trying to stay true to the translation. So I am going to read it in an uncensored fashion. So here we go. Yes, my eyes are closed to your light. I am a beast, a nigger, but I can be saved. You are sham niggers, you maniacs, fiends, misers, merchant. You are a nigger, judge, you are a nigger. General, you are a nigger. Emperor, old itch, you are a nigger. And you have drunk of the untaxed liquor of Satan still. Fever and cancer inspire this people. Cripples and old men are so respectable they are fit to be boiled. The smartest thing would be to leave this continent, where madness stalks to provide hostages for these wretches. I enter the true kingdom of the children of Ham. Do I know nature yet? Do I know myself? No more words. I bury the dead in my belly. Shouts, drums, dance, 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 dance. I cannot even see the time when white men landing. I shall fall into nothingness. Hunger, thirst, shouts, dance, 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 dance. The white men are landing, the cannon. We must submit to baptism, put on clothes, work. My heart has known the coup de grace. Ah, I did not foresee it. I have never done evil, light will my days be, and I shall be spared repentance. I shall not have known the torments of the soul, half dead to good, whence like funeral candles a grave light ascends. The fate of the sons of good families, the premature coffin covered with limpid tears. Certainly debauch is stupid, vice is stupid, all that is rotten must be cast aside. But the clock will not have succeeded in no longer striking only the hour of pure pain. Am I to be carried off like a child to play in paradise forgetful of all sorrow? Quick, are there other lives? Sleep and wealth is impossible. Wealth has always been public property. The keys of knowledge are the gifts of divine love alone. I see that nature is but the display of goodness. Farewell, chimeras, ideals, errors. The reasonable song of angels rises from the Savior ship. It is divine love, two loves. I can die of earthly love, die of devotion. I have abandoned souls whose pain will be increased by my going. Among the shipwrecked, you choose me. Those who remain, are they not my friends? Save them. Reason is born to me. The world is good. I will bless life. I will love my brothers. These are no longer childish promises, not the hope of escaping old age and death. God is my strength, and I praise God. Boredom is no longer my love. Rages, debauchery, madness. I have known all their soarings and their disasters. My whole burden is laid down. Let us contemplate undazed the extent of my innocence. I would no longer be capable of begging the solace of a bastinado. I don't fancy myself embarked on a wedding with Jesus Christ as father-in-law. I am not a prisoner of my reason. I said, God, I want freedom and salvation. How am I to seek it? Frivolous tastes have left me. No more need of devotion or of divine love. No more regrets for the age of tender hearts. Each of us has his reason, scorn, and charity. I reserve my place at the top of that angelic ladder of common sense. As for established happiness, domestic or not, no, I cannot. I am too dissipated, too weak. Life flourishing through toil, old platitudes. As for me, my life is not heavy enough. It flies and floats far above action, that precious focus of the world. What an old maid I am getting to be, lacking the courage to be in love with death. If only God would grant me celestial, aerial, calm prayer, like the ancient saints, giants, anchorites, artists, such as are not wanted anymore. Farce without end, my innocence would make me weep. Life is the farce we all have to lead. Enough. Here is the punishment. Forward, march. Ah, my lungs are on fire. My temples roar. In this sunlight, night rolls through my eyes, heart, limbs. Where are we going? To battle? I am weak. The others advance. Tools, weapons, time. Fire, fire on me, here. Or I surrender. Cowards, I'll kill myself. I'll throw myself under the horse's hooves. Ah, I shall get used to it. It would be the French way of life, the path of honor. Night of hell. I have swallowed a monstrous dose of poison. Thrice blessed be the counsel that came to me. My entrails are on fire. The violence of the venom twists my limbs, deforms and prostrates me. I die of thirst. I suffocate. I cannot scream. It is hell, eternal punishment. See how the fire flares up again. How nicely I burn. Go to it, demon. I had caught a glimpse of the conversion to good and to happiness, salvation. Can I describe the vision? The air of hell will tolerate no hymns. There were a million charming creatures, a melodious sacred concert, strength and peace, noble ambitions. I don't know what all. Noble ambitions? Still this is life. Suppose damnation were eternal. Then a man who would mutilate himself is well damned, isn't he? I think I am in hell. Therefore I am in hell. It is the execution of the catechism. I am the slave of my baptism. Parents, you have been my undoing, and your own. Poor innocent, hell has no power over pagans. This is life still. Later the delights of damnation will be more profound. A crime, quick, a crime that I may fall into nothingness, in accordance with human law. Be quiet, do be quiet, there's shame and reprobation here. Satan, who says that the fire is contemptible, that my anger is horribly silly, enough. Fallacies they whisper to me, sorceries, false perfumes, childish music, and to think that I possess truth, that I perceive justice. My judgment is sound and sure. I am ripe for perfection, pride. My scalp is drying up. Pity, Lord, I am afraid. I am thirsty, so thirsty. Ah, childhood. The grass, the rain, the lake over the stones. The moonlight where the bell was chiming 12. The devil is in the belfry at this hour. Mary, Holy Virgin, horror of my stupidity. Out there, are there not honest souls that wish me well? Come, I have a pillow over my mouth. They do not hear me, they are phantoms. Besides, no one ever thinks of others. Let no one come near me. I must smell scorched, I'm sure. Hallucinations are without number. Truly, that is what I've always known. No more faith in history, principles forgotten. I'll keep quiet about that. Poets and visionaries would be jealous. I am 1,000 times the richest. Let us be as avaricious as the sea. What? The clock of life stopped a while ago. I am no longer in the world. Theology is serious. Hell is certainly down below. In heaven, on high. Ecstasy, nightmare, and sleep in a nest of flames. What tricks of observation in the country? Satan, old Nick, runs with the wild grain. Jesus walks on the purple briars, and they do not bend. Jesus walked on the troubled waters. The lantern showed him to us, erect, white, with long brown hair on the flank of an emerald wave. I'm going to unveil all the mysteries, religious mysteries or natural mysteries, death, birth, the future, the past, cosmogony, nothingness. I am a master of phantasmagoria. Listen, I have all the talents. There is no one here, and there is someone. I would not squander my treasures. Do you want Negro songs, the dances of Hori? Do you want me to vanish, to dive after the ring? Is that what you want? I will make gold remedies. Have faith in me, then. Faith assuages, guides, restores. Come, all of you, even the little children, that I may comfort you, that my heart may be poured out for you, the marvelous heart. Poor men, toilers, I do not ask for prayers. With your trust alone I shall be happy. And what of me? All this hardly makes me regret the world very much. I am lucky not to suffer more. My life was nothing but sweet follies. It's a pity. Bah, let's practice every imaginable grimace. Decidedly, we are out of the world. No longer any sound. My sense of touch has left me. Ah, my castle, my Saxony, my willow wood. Evenings, mornings, nights, days, how weary I am. I should have my hell for anger, my hell for pride, and the hell of laziness, a symphony of hells. I die of lassitude. It is the tomb. I go to the worms, horror of horrors. Satan, you fraud, you would dissolve me with your charms. I insist, a thrust of the pitchfork, a drop of fire. Ah, to rise again into life, to cast our eyes on our deformities. And that poison, that kiss, a thousand times accursed. My weakness, the cruelty of the world. My God, pity, hide me. I behave too badly. I am hidden, and I am not. It is the fire that flares up again with its damned. Delirium, the foolish virgin, the infernal bridegroom. Let's hear now a hellmate's confession. O heavenly bridegroom, my lord, do not reject the confession of the saddest of your handmaidens. I am lost, I am drunk, I am unclean. What a life! Forgive me, heavenly lord, forgive me. Ah, forgive me. How many tears, how many more tears later, I hope. Later I shall know the heavenly bridegroom. I was born his slave. The other can beat me now. At present I am at the bottom of the world. Oh, my friends, no, not my friends. Never delirium and tortures like these. How stupid. Ah, I suffer, I scream, I really suffer. Yet everything is permitted me, burdened with the contempt of the most contemptible hearts. At any rate, let me tell you my secret, free to repeat it 20 times again, just as dreary, just as insignificant. I am the slave to the infernal bridegroom, the one who was the undoing of the foolish virgins. He is really that very demon. He is not a ghost, he is not a phantom. But I, who have lost all reason, who am damned and dead to the world, they will not kill me. How describe him to you? I can no longer even speak. I am in mourning. I weep. I am afraid. A little coolness, Lord, if you will, if you only will. I am a widow. I was a widow. Ah, yes, I was really serious once, and I was not born to be a skeleton. He was hardly more than a child. His mysterious delicacies had seduced me. I forgot all my duty to society to follow him. What a life! Real life is absent. We are not in the world. I go where he goes. I have to. And often he flies into a rage at me. Me, the poor soul, the demon. He is a demon. You know. He is not a man. He says, I do not like women. I must be reinvented, that's obvious. A secure position is all they're capable of desiring now. Security once gained, heart and beauty are set aside. Cold disdain alone is left. The food of marriage today, or else I see women marked with the signs of happiness, and whom could I have made my comrades, promptly devoured by brutes, with as much feeling as a log? I listen to him glorifying infamy, clothing cruelty with charm. I am of a distant race. My ancestors were Norsemen. They used to pierce their sides, drink their blood. I will cover myself with gashes, tattoo my body. I want to be as ugly as a Mongol. You'll see, I will howl through the streets. I want to become raving mad. Never show me jewels. I should grovel and writhe on the floor. My wealth, I'd want it spattered all over with blood. Never will I work. Many nights his demon would seize me, and rolling on the ground, I would wrestle with him. Often at night drunk, he lies in wait for me in streets, in houses, to frighten me to death. They will really cut my throat. It will be revolting. Oh, those days when he goes wrapped in an air of crime. Sometimes he speaks in a kind of melting dialect of death that brings repentance of all the miserable wretches there must be, of painful toil, of partings that lacerate the heart. In low dives where we'd get drunk, he used to weep for those around us, cattle of misery. He would lift up drunkards in the dark streets. He had the pity of a bad mother for little children. He would depart with the graces of a little girl going to her catechism. He pretended to have knowledge of everything, business, art, medicine. I followed him. I had to. Which in his mind he surrounded himself. Clothing, fabrics, furniture. I lent him arms, another face. I saw everything relating to him as he would have liked to create it for himself. When his mind seemed absent, I followed him. Yes, I, in strange and complicated actions, very far, good or bad, I was certain of never entering his world. How many hours of the night, beside his dear sleeping body, I kept watch, trying to understand why he so longed to escape reality. Never a man had such a wish. I realized without any fear for him that he could be a serious danger to society. Perhaps he has some secrets for changing life. No, I would say to myself, he is only looking for them. In short, his charity is bewitched, and I its prisoner. No other soul would have enough strength, strength of despair, to endure it, to be protected and loved by him. Moreover, I never imagined him with another soul. One sees one's own angel, never the angel of another. I believe. I was in his soul as in a palace they had emptied, so that no one should see so mean a person as oneself. That was all. Alas, I was really dependent on him. But what could he want with my dull, my craven life? He was making me no better if he wasn't driving me to death. Sometimes, chagrined and sad, I said to him, "I understand you." He would shrug his shoulders. Thus my sorrow always renewed, and seeming in my eyes more lost than ever, as in the eyes of all who might have watched me, had I not been condemned to be forgotten by all forever. I hungered for his kindness more and more. With his kisses and his friendly arms, it was really heaven, a somber heaven into which I entered and where I longed to be left, poor and deaf and dumb and blind. Already it had grown into a habit. I thought of us as two good children, free to wander in the paradise of sadness. We were congenial to each other. Much moved, we used to work together. But after a profound caress, he would say, "How queer it will seem to you when I am no longer here. All you have gone through. When you no longer have my arm beneath your head, nor my heart for resting place, nor these lips upon your eyes. For I shall have to go away, very far away, one day. After all, I must help others, too. It is my duty. Not that it's very tempting, dear heart." Right away I saw myself, with him gone. My senses reeling, hurled into the most horrible darkness, death. I used to make him promise never to leave me. He made it 20 times, that lover's promise. It was as vain as when I said to him, "I understand you." I have never been jealous of him. He will not leave me, I believe. What would become of him? He knows nothing. He will never work. He wants to live a sleepwalker. Would his goodness and his charity alone give him the right to live in the real world? There are moments when I forget the abjection to which I have fallen. He will make me strong. We will travel, hunt in the deserts. We will sleep on the pavements of unknown cities, uncared for and without a care. Or else I shall awake and the laws and customs will have changed, thanks to his magic powers. Or the world, while remaining the same, will leave me to my desires, joys, heedlessness. Oh, the life of adventure and children's books to recompense me. I have suffered so, will you give me that? He cannot. His ideal is unknown to me. He has told me he has regrets, hopes. They can't have anything to do with me. Does he talk to God? I should appeal to God, perhaps. I am in the lowest depths, and I can no longer pray. If he explained his sadness to me, would I understand it any more than his mockery? He assails me. He spends hours making me ashamed of everything in the world that may have touched me, and is indignant if I weep. You see that elegant young man going into the beautiful, calm house? His name is Duval, Dufour, Armand, Maurice, or God knows what. A woman has devoted her life to loving that wicked idiot. She is dead. She must be a saint in heaven now. You will kill me as he has killed that woman. It is our lot, the lot of us, charitable hearts. Alas, he had days when all busy men seemed to him grotesque playthings of delirium. He would laugh long and horribly. Then he would revert to his manners of a young mother, a big sister. If he were less untamed, we should be saved. But his tenderness, too, is deadly. I am his slave. Ah, I am mad. One day, perhaps, he will miraculously disappear. But I must know if he is to ascend into some heaven again, so that I'll be sure not to miss the assumption of my little lover. Queer couple. Delirium. Alchemy of the word. Now for me, the story of one of my follies. For a long time I boasted of possessing every possible landscape, and held in derision the celebrities of modern painting and poetry. I loved maudlin pictures, the painted panels over doors, stage sets, the backdrops of mountebanks, old ensigns, popular prints, antiquated literature, church Latin, erotic books, innocent of all spelling, the novels of our grandfathers, fairy tales, children's storybooks, old operas, inane refrains and artless rhythms. I dreamed crusades, unrecorded voyages of discovery, untroubled republics, religious wars stifled, revolutions of customs. The displacements of races and continents, I believed in all marvels. I invented the color of vowels, A, black, E, white, I, red, O, blue, U, green. I regulated the form and the movement of every consonant, and with instinctive rhythms I prided myself on inventing a poetic language accessible someday to all of the senses. I reserved all rights of translation. At first it was an experiment. I wrote silences. I wrote the night. I recorded the inexpressible. I fixed frenzies in their flight. Far from birds and flocks and village girls, what did I drink as I knelt in the heather? A tender hazel copse around me, in the warm green mist of the afternoon. What could I drink in that young waza, voiceless the trees, flowerless the grass, sky overcast, drink at those yellow gourds far from my cabin, so dear, liqueurs of gold that bring heavy sweating? I seemed a sorry sign for an inn. A storm came chasing the sky away, and virgin sands. Drank all the water of the evening woods. God's wind blew icicles into the ponds. As I wept, I saw gold, and could not drink. Morning, summer, 4 o'clock, deep still love sleep endures, while fetid evening's odors from the green bowers evaporate. Down in their vast wood yards, under an Hesperian sun, the carpenters in shirt sleeves toil already. Calm in their deserts of moss, precious canopies preparing, where the city will paint skies fabulous and false. Oh, for those charming workers, subjects of a Babylonian king, Venus, a moment leave the lovers, whose souls are wreathed. O queen of shepherds, bring to the workers wine, that their powers be appeased, awaiting the noon swim in the sea. Poetic quaintness played a large part in my alchemy of the word. I became an adept at simple hallucination. In place of a factory, I really saw a mosque, a school of drummers led by angels, carriages on the highway of the sky. A drawing room at the bottom of a lake, monsters, mysteries. The title of a melodrama would raise horrors before me. Then I would explain my magic sophisms with the hallucination of words. Finally, I came to regard as sacred the disorder of my mind. I was idle, full of a sluggish fever. I envied the felicity of beasts, caterpillars that represent the innocence of limbo, moles, the sleep of virginity. My temper soured. In kinds of ballads, I said farewell to the world. Song of the highest tower. Oh, may it come, the time of love, the time we'd be enamored of. I've been patient too long, my memory is dead. All fears and all wrongs to the heavens have fled, while all my veins burst with a sickly thirst. Oh, may it come, the time of love, the time we'd be enamored of. Like the meadows that is dreaming, forgetful of cares, flourishing and flowering with incense and tares, where fierce buzzings rise of filthy flies. Oh, may it come, the time of love, the time we'd be enamored of. I love the desert, dry orchards, faded shops and tepid drinks. I dragged myself through stinking alleys, and eyes closed, I gave myself to the sun, god of fire. General, if on your ruined ramparts an old cannon remains, bombard us with lumps of dried mud. On the mirrors of magnificent shops, in drawing rooms, make the city eat its dust. Oxidize the water spouts. Fill boudoirs with the burning powder of rubies. Oh, the drunken fly in the inn's privy, enamored of borage, dissolved by a sunbeam. Hunger. If I've a taste, it's not alone for the earth and stones, rocks, coal, iron, air. That's my daily fare. Turn my hunger's brows on the field of sound. Suck up bindweed's gay venom along the ground. Eat the pebbles that one breaks, church's old stones, gravel of ancient deluge taste, and loaves scattered in gray breaks. Howling underneath the leaves, the wolf spits out the lovely plumes of his feast of fowls. Like him, I am consumed. Salads and fruits await but the picking, but violets are the food of spiders in the thicket. Let me sleep, let me seethe at the altars of Solomon. Broth run over the rust and mix with the cedron. At last, O happiness, O reason, I brushed from the sky the azure that is darkness, and I lived, gold spark of pure light. Out of joy I took on an expression as clownish and blank as possible. It is recovered. What? Eternity. It is the sea mixed with the sun. My soul eternal, redeem your promise, in spite of the night alone and the day on fire. Of human suffrage, of common aspirings, you free yourself then, you fly according to. Hope nevermore, no orator, science and patience, retribution is sure. No more tomorrow's embers of satin, your ardor is now, your duty only. It is recovered, what eternity? It is the sea mixed with the sun. I became a fabulous opera. I saw that all creatures have a fatality of happiness. Action is not life, but only a way of spoiling some force, an enervation. Morality is the weakness of the brain. It seemed to me that to every creature several other lives were due. The gentleman knows not what he does. He is an angel. This family is a litter of puppies. With several men I have spoken aloud with a moment of one of their other lives. Thus it was I loved a pig. Not a single sophistry of madness, madness to be confined, was forgotten. I could recite them all again. I know the system. My health was threatened. Terror came. I would fall into a slumber of days, and getting up would go on with the same sad dreams. I was ripe for death, and along a road of perils my weakness led me to the confines of the world and of Samaria, home of whirlwinds and of darkness. I had to travel, divert the spells assembled in my brain, over the sea that I loved as though it were to cleanse me of a stain. I saw the comforting cross arise. I had been damned by the rainbow. Happiness was my fatality, my remorse, my worm. My life would always be too enormous to be devoted to strength and to beauty. Happiness, its tooth deadly sweet, warned me at the crowning of the cock. Ad matutinum. At the Christus venit in the darkest cities. O seasons, O castles, what soul is without sin? The magic study I've made of happiness none can evade. To it each time, good luck, we hear the Gallic cock. No more desires for me, it has taken my life in fee. Charmed body, soul, and brain, delivered of every stain, O seasons, O castles, the hour of flight will be the hour of death for me. O seasons, O castles, that is over, now I know how to salute beauty. The Impossible. Ah, that life of my childhood, the high road in all weathers, supernaturally sober, more disinterested than the best of beggars, proud to have neither country nor friends, how stupid it was, and I see it only now. I was right to despise those poor fellows who would never miss the chance of a caress, parasites of the cleanliness and health of our women, now that they are so little in accord with us. I was right in all my contempt since I escape. I escape? I'll explain. Yesterday I was still sighing. Heavens, aren't there enough of us damned ones here below? How long I've spent already in their troop. I know them all. We recognize each other always. We disgust each other. Charity is unknown to us, but we are civil. Our relations with the world are most correct. It is surprising, the world, tradesmen, simple souls, we are not dishonored. But the elect, how would they receive us? Now there are the surly and joyous ones, the false elect, since we would need daring or humility to approach them. They are the only elect. They are not those who bless. Having recovered 2 cents worth of reason, it is soon gone. I see that my disquietudes come from having understood too late that we are in the Occident. Occidental swamps. Not that I think light faded, form shrunk, movement lost. Well, here is my spirit insisting on taking upon itself all the cruel developments that the spirit has suffered since the end of the Orient. It really insists, my spirit. My 2 cents worth of reason is spent. Spirit is in command. It insists that I be in the Occident. I'd have to silence it to conclude as I wished. To the devil, I said, with martyrs' crowns. The beams of art, the pride of inventors, the ardor of plunderers. I return to the Orient and to the first and eternal wisdom. A dream of vulgar indolence, it would seem. Yet I was hardly thinking of the pleasure of escaping modern wretchedness. I was not thinking of the bastard wisdom of the Quran. But is there not real torment in this, that, ever since that declaration of science, Christianity, man fools himself, proves to himself the obvious, puffs himself up with the pleasure of reiterating those proofs, and can live in no other way? Subtle, silly torture, source of all my spiritual vagrancies. Nature can be bored, perhaps. Monsieur Prudhomme was born with Christ. Is it not because we cultivate fog, we eat fever with our watery vegetables, and drunkenness, and tobacco, and ignorance, and self-sacrifice? How far all this is from the conception, from the wisdom of the Orient, the original fatherland. Why a modern world if such poisons are invented? Churchmen will say granted, but you mean Eden. Nothing for you in the history of Oriental peoples. It is true, it is of Eden I was thinking. What has it to do with my dream, that purity of ancient races? Philosophers, the world has no age. Humanity simply changes place. You are in the Occident, but free to live in your Orient, as ancient as you please, and to live well. Don't admit defeat. Philosophers, you are of your Occident. My spirit, beware. No violent projects of salvation. Bestir yourself. Ah, for us science is too slow, but I see that my spirit is asleep. If it were always wide awake from that moment on, we should soon reach the truth that may even now surround us with her weeping angels. If it had been awake till this very instant, that would mean I had not yielded to my deleterious instincts in an immemorial age. If it had always been wide awake, I should be under full sail on the high sea of wisdom. Oh, purity, purity, it is this moment of awakening that has given me the vision of purity. Through the spirit we go to God. Heartbreaking misfortune. Lightning flash. Human toil, that is the explosion which lights up my abyss from time to time. Nothing is vanity, all for science and forward, cries the modern Ecclesiastes. That is to say, everybody. And yet the corpses of the wicked and the sluggards fall on the hearts of others. Ah, hurry, do hurry, out there beyond the night, those future, those eternal rewards. Shall we escape them? What can I do? I know what toil is, and science is too slow. Let prayer gallop and light thunder. I see it clearly. It is too simple, and it's too hot. They will get along without me. I have my duty. I shall be proud of it after the fashion of several others by setting it aside. My life is threadbare. All right. Let sham and shirk. Oh, pity, and we will go on enjoying ourselves. dreaming monstrous loves, fantastic universes, grumbling and quarreling with the world's disguises, mountebank, beggar, artist, scoundrel, priest. On my hospital bed, the odor of incense came back to me so potent, guardian of the sacred aromatics, confessor, martyr. There I recognized the filthy education of my childhood. What of it? To go my 20 years if others go their 20 years? No, no, now I rebel against death. Toil seems too trifling to my pride. My betrayal to the world would be too brief a torture. At the last moment I would strike out, to the right, to the left. Then, oh dear, poor soul, would not eternity be lost to us? Had I not once a lovely youth, heroic, fabulous, to be written on sheets of gold, good luck and to spare? Through what crime, through what fault, have I deserved my weakness now? You who declare that beasts sob in their grief, that the sick despair, that the dead have bad dreams, try to relate my fall in my sleep. As for me, I can no more explain myself than the beggar with his endless paters and Ave Marias. I can no longer speak. However, I have finished, I think, the tale of my hell today. It was really hell, the old hell, the one whose doors were opened by the Son of Man. From the same desert and the same night, always my tired eyes awake to the silver star. Always, but the kings of life are not moved, the three magi, mind and heart and soul. When shall we go beyond the mountains and the shores to greet the birth of new toil, of new wisdom, the flight of tyrants, of demons, the end of superstition, to adore, the first to adore, Christmas on the earth, the song of the heavens, the marching of peoples. Slaves, let us not curse life. Farewell. Autumn already? But why regret an eternal sun if we are embarked on the discovery of divine light, far from all those who fret over seasons? Autumn, risen through the motionless mists, our boat turns toward the port of misery, the enormous city with fire and mud-stained sky. Ah, the putrid rags, the rain-soaked bread, drunkenness, the thousand loves that have crucified me. Will she never have done, then, that ghoul queen of a million dead souls and dead bodies, and which will be judged? I see myself again, skin rotten with mud and pest, worms in my armpits and in my hair, and in my heart much bigger worms, lying among strangers without age, without feeling. I might have died there. Unbearable evocation. I loathe poverty. And I dread winter because it is the season of comfort. Sometimes in the sky I see endless beaches covered with white nations full of joy. Above me a great golden ship waves its multicolored pennants in the breezes of the morning. I created all fêtes, all triumphs, all dramas. I tried to invent new flowers, new stars, new flesh, new tongues. I thought I was acquiring supernatural powers. Well, I must bury my imagination in my memories, in artists and storytellers' precious fame flung away. I who called myself angel or seer, exempt from all mortality, I am returned to the soil with a duty to seek and rough reality to embrace. Peasant, am I mistaken? Would charity be the sister of death for me? At last I shall ask forgiveness for having fed on lies. And now let's go. But no friendly hand, and where turn for help? Yes, the new hour is at least very severe, for I can say that victory is won, the gnashing of teeth, the hissings of fire, the pestilential sighs are abating, all the noisome memories are fading, my last regrets take to their heels, envy of beggars, brigands, of death's friends, of the backward of all kinds, O damned ones, what if I avenged myself? One must be absolutely modern, no hymns, hold the ground gained. Arduous night, the dried blood smokes on my face, and I have nothing behind me but that horrible bush. Spiritual combat is as brutal as the battle of men, but the vision of justice is the pleasure of God alone. Meanwhile, this is the vigil. Welcome, then, all the influx of vigor and real tenderness. And in the dawn, armed with an ardent patience, we shall enter magnificent cities. Why talk of a friendly hand? My great advantage is that I can laugh at old lying loves and put to shame those deceitful couples. I saw the hell of women back there, and I shall be free to possess truth in one soul and one body. April through August, 1873. That concludes Arthur Rimbaud's A Season in Hell. I know some of you take issue with my pronunciation of his name. Please forgive my barbaric American accent. It's one of my all-time favorite poems by one of my all-time favorite poets. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for listening.